Ladies and gentlemen, General John J. Sheehan, NATO's Supreme Allied Commander Atlantic and Commander-in-Chief of U.S. Atlantic Command.
Those of you who are here today are observing an absolutely historic event. The soldiers that you see before you represent not the past, but rather the future. It is through exercises such as this that truly we can create a new world order.
Ļoti skaisti. Nu, bet kā izskatījās mūsu karavīri, to lai mums spriežu tie, kas skatījās mūsu karavīri.
Colonel says that this exercise, peacekeeping exercise, is very impressive, and he would like to thank the United States Army and government as and United States as a nation for this very big, great job and big expenses to organize this exercise. And the opening ceremony was nice and impressive too.
Attention, attention, attention. American forces are here to help. Remain calm. We will not tolerate civil disobedience.
Hello, I'm Alex Jones, and I'm a radio and television host based in Austin, Texas. And for many years, I've been exposing the criminal activities of the global elite, otherwise known as the New World Order. The newest film you're about to see is Police State 2, The Takeover. Now, in past films, we went in depth showing the merger between military and the police under the control of the FBI and the ever-growing, powerful central government. In the new film, we're going to show you the result. The military out serving search warrants in 77 Texas counties. That's right, civilian search warrants. We're not talking about Mexico or Russia. We're talking about Texas, USA. The military running checkpoints in Granger County, Tennessee, random on the nation's highways. Not looking for spies or axe murderers. No, just making sure that you haven't been out drinking and driving or using drugs. It's a drug war, you know. Then we'll go into who's bringing in the drugs, the CIA, and who they're working for, the big foreign banks. My friends, all of the key indicators of a nation in massive decline are being manifest in front of our eyes right now as we speak. In North Carolina, the FBI, the BATF, and Pinkerton Security Corporation have created a public-private operation with the state. They plan to make it go worldwide, not just nationwide, in the next few years, implementing the global government through the public schools, through the government training centers. They have the children tattling on their parents, their neighbors, their peers in school, and getting rewards for it, CD players, toys, and discount credit cards. Everything you would expect to see in Nazi Germany or Russia. My friends, this is the battle for the Republic. It's a hardcore battle that we've all got to face, that we've all got to get involved in. Just a few weeks ago, in March of 2000, Admiral Moore, former chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, called for all Americans, black, white, young, old, it doesn't matter, to engage in the information war or we're going to lose our country. The globalists see this nation as a shining jewel, to be subdivided, to be strip-mined socially. It's time for all Americans to wake up, to energize and get involved. In past films, I've implored the public to take action, to make copies of these documentaries, to give them to their police chief or their sheriff or to their local politician. There are many ways to get involved, and at the end of this film, we're going to have some solutions, very important solutions, different ways that we can get this country back. And yes, face it, my friends, if we can't get it back in an information capacity, if the corruption, if the criminal activity continues, if the government continues to drive forward in their mad desire to disarm the American people and complete our journey towards slavery, it will become physical. Let's hope that doesn't have to happen in the next few years. And one more positive note. Take my last film, Police State 2000, or the one before that, America Destroyed by Design. I requested that my listeners and my viewers from my television show in Austin and my radio program, as well as my nationally syndicated broadcast, make copies of my documentaries to play them on Access Television, to show them to university or high school students. The effect has been massive. The effect has been massive because of you, not because of me. I bring you the evidence. You check it out. Again, don't believe what I say. Document and research the different things you're about to see. And when you find out it's real, I know that you'll fight it with even more earnest. I can't even do a radio interview now, and I do between 5 to 10 a week, without callers calling in who have seen my films. And guess what? Very few of them ever got them from me. They got them from you. And I wanted to publicly, here in the new film, thank all of you. God bless, my friends. It's a battle for the Republic against dehumanization and total slavery. Get involved and be part of history. It's the right thing to do. God bless. Here are just a few scenes from the last documentary, Police State 2000, to bring you up to speed on some of the more horrific developments. Then we'll move into their manifestations out in the public sector.
Hello, Waffen SS.
I would have said that, Alex.
Get the searchlights.
Yahoo, my friend.
Gabul.
Come on, sir. Let me go.
Need to get to the town mayor. She's in a meeting.
Okay, let's go ahead and bring those two in.
Thank you.
We need to get fed. Where are we going to get fed?
Let us out there, sir.
What'd you see? What'd you hear?
Well, there were throwing some bombs, you know, bombing.
Right.
Yeah. And some, I think they were using some rifles too, and the other kind of rifles, you know, the one you know, stuff like that.
Because what they would do, once I said no,
They went to various individuals in the community to bring pressure to bear to get me to change my mind. For example, there was a community leader who I have a great deal of respect for, and we have a very good relationship that they went to. I get a call from him, and he says, Chief, there's some people in here that they're in town, and it was part of their role here. Didn't say who it was. They need to meet with the mayor and the police chief. Well, of course, this gentleman, I've worked very closely with him on a number of projects. I said, sure, have him give me a call. Now, I'd already said no. Well, then I find out it's the same group. So they identified somebody apparently that I know that's very high in the community to make an approach to me and get me to change my mind. Well, then when we said no, then some elected officials were contacted to bring pressure to bear. And then offers were made to give money, cash money, to elected officials' charities if they could get us to change our minds. I mean, as one of my deputy chiefs said, in some circles that's called bribery.
And you're just going to go into regular citizens' homes doing this?
Actually, the citizens have volunteered their services. They volunteered to be role players.
Uh-huh.
And they've allowed us to use their homes.
And what are they going to do? Are there any of them going to act like they don't want you to do it? Or they're all going to act like they don't want you to do it?
Well, some are going to be friendly. Some are going to be belligerent. You know, some are going to be uncooperative.
Uh-huh.
I think the best way if you find out about the check is when I operate some people down here.
Operation people?
Yeah, in the front.
We're a fraction occupying an Air Force.
Yeah.
The steersman been taken over.
Okay.
And we're going to have a meeting in here, so we please ask you to leave.
Okay. Leave the municipal airport? Sure we will.
No, leave the terminal building.
Leave the terminal building. Okay, thanks a lot.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Thanks for the help.
Yesterday's right to peaceably assemble has given way to a declaration of civil emergency and mass arrests today.
Your conduct is in violation of state and city law, and your failure to leave the area now will subject you to arrest for failure to disperse.
The stance of the city and the state is vastly different, with State Patrol and National Guard backing up the Seattle police. Innocent bystanders walking along the sidewalk are getting tear gassed, and while the governor made assurances this morning things are back to normal, they're definitely not.
The state of emergency was just an hour old.
The state of emergency that they've been training for so long to deal with. Who was behind it? What caused it in Seattle in December of 1999? The World Trade Organization meeting. The riots, the supposed riots in the military and police working together to keep the public safe from all that evil rabble. We're going to go in depth. This is a perfect textbook example of problem, reaction, solution. Training the public that the wheeled tanks keep us safe. But first, we have to examine the World Trade Organization, the WTO, to understand what happened in Seattle. The World Trade Organization was created in 1995. By the same institutions, the same powerful central banks that created the United Nations and empowered it in the late 1940s. They seek to destroy national sovereignty, not just in America, but worldwide, and rein it in under the control of a huge dictatorial machine. And their track record is clear. They are nothing more than servants of the corrupt global establishment, serving their every whim, dividing up the property on the global plantation. If one reads the different trade agreements that have been pushed by this World Trade Organization, energized in the last 5 years to world prominence, one realizes that it's nothing but a tool for consolidation. There's one catch. In recent years, the WTO, since its inception, has come across incredible opposition worldwide because of its obvious authoritarian implications. That's a hard thing to deal with when you've got highly motivated people that have real complaints and valid issues. How do you deal with it? Well, you simply call in your friends. The left coast communists posing as anarchists under Delta Force direction.
Broke windows of the Gap. They're smashing
washing windows at McDonald's. They're dumping over garbage cans. And they are very angry again and hostile. We're seeing more clashes with other protesters telling them to stop because they're giving everyone a bad name. None of the protesters, the legitimate protesters down here, want any of this kind of action. And they are very angry.
So right now, knocking on the newspaper.
Megan, any sign yet of police trying to track them down?
No riot police anywhere. They're going like... They're breaking the bank window here at U.S. Bank. We got to get out of here. We're going to run up the street because if they see us, they attack us. And so we're keeping a safe distance away from them.
Several police officers have told us because they were assigned to control the protest crowds, they weren't allowed to break ranks and to stop the black bloc. So the group just continued destroying property for nearly an hour.
What's wrong with this picture? If the police are supposedly there to protect the public and property, then why? Why did state police, Seattle police, as well as the feds, stand back and allow the anarchists in mass to run around and throw bottles at police, cones, rocks, you name it, and assault private property as well as members of the general public? Because they needed someone to demonize the rest of the good demonstrators. Now, my friends, this is an old tactic throughout history. If you have opposition, you simply demonize them by creating your own crisis, your own massacre or terrorist bombing or incident, and then blaming it on your political opponents. When you have 50, 60,000 peaceful demonstrators out exposing the corruption, how do you neutralize them? Well, you simply send in your boys to create a crisis to offer a solution. Now, we're not saying that local police knew what was going on. Certainly not. They just were following their orders, which is frightening in and of itself, to let a bunch of anarchists, 30 or 40 of them tops, run around and burn and break things because they were ordered to do so. We're going to play you some little clips from newscast and some amateur video. Then we'll move into even more evidence that this was a government action. You see, the anarchists were actually given their own operations base, even during the curfew and civil emergency that was declared after their attacks. Boy, that was a good excuse to clear the streets. But first, watch just a small snippet of a local newscast that, of course, never went nationwide. Can't have the people finding out about what really happened. It's very revealing how the police just go along and allow this criminal activity. Then we'll get into who was behind it and how most of the anarchists are just useful idiots working for their provocateur bosses, and on into the state of emergency that was declared and how not just Seattle but the nation was trained to accept armored personnel carriers and police in black uniforms as well as National Guard being directed by the FBI and the Justice Department and Delta Force is all part of living in a safe society to, well, you know, protect us from those dangerous anarchists.
A group we had seen all morning, a group we now know as anarchists called the Black Bloc, began terrorizing the city. I was live on the phone as it started.
Trying to break the windows. They're slamming against the window. Oh, my gosh. They just broke the Starbucks window. They're breaking into it right now. I'm moving across the street.
It was a frightening moment, and I think I was in shock. I had been separated from my photographer, but as I followed this group, I soon met up with another Cairo photographer, Frank Simon, as the group's rage turned toward him. Photographer Eric Wald and I then followed the Black Bloc. There were about 30 of them, isolated by their black clothing, black hoods, and masks. It was obvious as they continued their destruction that they were renegade protesters.
Yeah, take off the mask. Take off your f***ing mask and join the rest of us and shut up!
Now we're at the McDonald's at Third and Pine, where they are breaking more windows. They broke windows at the Gap. They're smashing windows at McDonald's. They're dumping over garbage cans. And they are very angry again and hostile. We're seeing more clashes with other protesters telling them to stop because they're giving everyone a bad name. None of the protesters, the legitimate protesters down here, want any of this kind of action. And they are very angry.
So right now, knocking on the newspaper.
Megan, any sign yet of police trying to track them down?
No riot police anywhere. They're going like... They're breaking the bank window here at U.S. Bank. We got to get out of here. We're going to run up the street because if they keeping a safe distance away from them.
Several police officers have told us because they were assigned to control the protest crowds, they weren't allowed to break ranks and to stop the black bloc. So the group just continued destroying property for nearly an hour.
King 5's Deborah Feldman spoke to one police officer who says the department suffered from bad leadership. She's live tonight with this exclusive story. Deb?
Well, I spoke with a detective tonight who says he feels completely demoralized by the way police were treated last week. He says he's not just talking about the treatment they received from protesters, but also from some of their superiors. It's hard for most people to witness chaos and destruction. But Detective Donnie Lowe says as a police officer at the scene...
I was embarrassed.
Lowe and his fellow officers were under orders to hold their ground last Tuesday when protesters blocked access to the convention center. He says it was painful to watch the crowd harass delegates and not be able to help them. He wasn't even allowed to catch the crooks looting downtown businesses.
I watched this guy loot Nike Town. Sit in the window of Nike Town. At some point in time, the employees of Nike Town were chased out, and they came running to us for assistance. And what we wasn't allowed to do anything.
Detective Lowe has half the answer right. He's got half the picture in his hands. Certainly, it's horrible. It's inexcusable that city leaders, under the control of the federal government in Seattle, would instruct the police not to apprehend criminals while they were engaging in crimes publicly. Crimes like robbery, arson, and assault. That makes the police chief, the mayor, the Justice Department, the Delta Force, the FBI, you name them, running this operation guilty as accomplices. But in a second, Detective Lowe falls for the old trick we've been talking so much about. Problem, reaction, solution. He says, you know, we were attacked out there for a day. But, you know, later the city got it together and we went ahead and declared the emergency. Why, we had the no protest zone. Yeah, half the city. Why, the civil emergency was needed. We finally, you know, we got to get tough on them. Yeah, you got to get tough on all the peaceful demonstrators that were shutting down the WTO, the World Trade Organization, and now when people think of protesters across the country, especially city leaders, city managers and others say, boy, we better crack down, we better ban protest here too. And they're passing ordinances across the nation to implement emergencies whenever they feel like it. And the federal government is rubbing its hands together. All started by 30 to 40 anarchists running around, burning and beating and smashing and stealing. And the police, like dogs at the end of a chain, a Rottweiler you've been slapping, suddenly had their leashes released, and with wanton abandon, they rampaged out in a berserk fashion and attacked old ladies, store owners, you name it. And then they got to ship everybody to the FEMA center. That's right. FEMA was helping during this learning process for everyone. Wake up, police. Stop letting them manipulate you.
Even though the department has been criticized for the so-called no-protest zones, Lowe defends them as necessary to regain control of the city.
I think our biggest problem here was... leadership within this department refused to take appropriate actions when it was clearly necessary. And that's how it got out of hand.
You see, police, things were meant to get out of hand, to train the public to live in a continual state of emergency. Martial law is not some Hollywood pronouncement. It's an incremental slide towards more and more control. And on a scale of 1 to 10... on the police state Richter scale, we're at a 4 or a 5 right now in America.
While the labor march was large and peaceful, it was the unexpected violence that captured most of the media attention.
There's three issues of mischaracterization that have been sort of compounded by ignorance that I really think need to be addressed. Number one, the civil emergency was created by the police. Yeah! The police did nothing but stand there until there was enough property damage, and then suddenly there was a civil emergency. Now this occurred, and I have to add also that the emergency meeting of the city council on Monday I want to thank the three members who actually voted not to endorse the mayor's proclamation of civil emergency. But I find it very disappointing that there was no debate on the actual merits of the civil emergency. Everyone just said, oh, well, it's quite clear. Media reports say that the negotiators in front of the King County Jail won a real concession from the police by granting access to attorneys to the people who were being held in the prison. This is not something to negotiate. This is a right. And it took a court order to even get to that point. And I'd like to know what state the police and the jail system is in when this can happen to nonviolent protesters who are simply being held. And we were told beforehand that in meetings with the police that no one would be held at Sandpoint for more than half an hour. Now, I don't think that was realistic. In fact, that's sort of such an Alice in Wonderland kind of thing to say that I don't really have a response to it.
I am very upset that my civil rights were suspended by Mayor Paul Schell so that WTO delegates could convene in our city. My freedom of movement was restricted, and I was subjected to harassment and arrest by the police. I was also subject to an excessive fine and 180 days in jail just for trying to protect myself from chemical poisoning by owning a gas mask. This private property was subject to confiscation by the police. A no-protest zone was created, which made it impossible for citizens to peaceably assemble and exercise free speech. I do not appreciate being gassed when I'm trying to get home from work or when I'm trying to shop downtown. I was nowhere near any of the demonstrations. Both times I was tear gassed. I suffered headaches and sinus pain for days afterwards, and I was forced to seek a physician's care. I also witnessed clouds of tear gas wafting out over the reservoir on Capitol Hill where our drinking water comes from. I would like the city council to look into the effects of chemical poisoning of our water. Just because a small group of vandals caused property damage downtown on one night, it does not give the city government or Governor Locke the right to deny my personal liberties and to gas law-abiding citizens. Every time there is a Super Bowl victory party, a World Soccer Championship, or Halloween in Detroit, much more property damage results. This has nothing to do with politics. Nonviolent civil disobedience is a very American tradition. Martin Luther King Jr., Henry David Thoreau, Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks. Without public protest, we would still have slavery, and even white women would not have the right to vote. I would want the city council to look into the federal government's role in these events as well. These protesters were held at a FEMA installation at Sandpoint, and I'd like to know what happened to the foreign nationals who were arrested, and are they in trouble with the INS? Thank you.
There were people who were willing to get arrested because they knew what they were intending to do might be illegal. They might intend to block an area. But instead of arresting those people, an entire community was assaulted with chemical substances.
Those here claim riot police attacked people on the street indiscriminately. Whether they were a protester or a resident living nearby, it didn't matter. Riot police attacked people on the street indiscriminately. Riot police attacked people on the street indiscriminately. Street indiscriminately. Indiscriminately.
The medical bills are going to be enormous for me.
I attempted to get help. The gentleman who said that there were people guarding the windows. There were peaceful demonstrators guarding the windows. There were also those of us who broke off from them, attempted to get a police officer, mind you, the police officers who were standing a dozenfold behind seated demonstrators with their arms linked, who quite obviously were not going anywhere, and I don't believe weighed over 100 pounds, any of them. I could not get one of them to break away to help me stop the violence that was going on. I want some answers. I definitely want some answers. I am very, very angry in that regard. But I think they ought to be reminded they are public servants.
Right.
We're about to get to hardcore evidence proving that the Federal Emergency Management Agency, that secret government system, was actually running the show. But first, even more evidence that the city was aiding and abetting the criminal anarchist.
We've all witnessed the confrontations over the past few days. At times, it's hard to tell whether police are protecting citizens or threatening them. When two apparent Good Samaritans stop to help a fallen woman, they all get pepper sprayed. Even media members weren't spared.
If you thought the anarchists who commandeered a privately owned downtown building were out of town now, well, think again. As Cairo 7 Eyewitness News reporter Christina McKenna has found out, they're still here and still living rent-free.
Susan, when these anarchists moved out of the building behind me on Saturday, a lot of people thought they should have been headed to jail. Instead, it turns out a lot of them just headed around the corner, and they're now living in a building right over here where they're enjoying electricity, hot water, and heat, all rent-free. Saturday afternoon was a celebration here. 7 days after they commandeered this downtown building, anarchists walked away without a word from police.
It feels to me like we won.
And at least some are still winning. As part of the deal to get them to surrender this building, anarchists were offered housing just around the corner at the same price. The building is owned by the Low Income Housing Institute, a private nonprofit that is in large part funded by the city and is now working with the city to house the anarchists.
First of all, with criminal trespassing, if that was me or you or the average person out in the street, we'd be in jail.
John Satoli can't believe the anarchists aren't in jail now. As a lawful tenant in the building the anarchists had seized, he was locked out of his packaging and shipping business for a week during his busiest season. Satoli can't believe he's now contemplating bankruptcy, and the people who put them there have paid no consequence at all.
They walked away. They walked away, and the city of Seattle, low-income housing, moved them across the street on me and yours, taxpayers' dollars.
So why didn't the police department arrest the anarchists when they moved out of that building? Well, that's a question a lot of people are asking, especially since the West Precinct is just down the block. We asked the police department this weekend. We asked them again today. They still haven't returned our call with an answer.
The riotous behavior I saw was by the Seattle Police Department, the Washington State Patrol, and the Federal Bureau of Investigations.
From the city's standpoint, we had security. And at least 20 agencies were involved. We had the lead, but clearly the Secret Service, the FBI, all of the state and local agencies dealing with security, the Port of Seattle, ATF, and a lot of work from traveling to Geneva to looking at the NATO conference in Washington, D.C., trying to do the best they could to understand what both the threat was and then how to plan to do it.
It just makes me furious.
Building owner Wal Louis says he wanted police to arrest the demonstrators who occupied his three-story building at the start of WTO meetings. He says they left a mess.
We're just cleaning up the mess right now. There's some human waste up there that we haven't removed and nobody wants to touch it. We'll try to find an outfit to do that.
Instead of eviction, police asked housing activists to negotiate with demonstrators. Sharon Lee of the Low Income Housing Institute convinced the protesters to voluntarily leave the building, in part by offering them temporary housing in a private nonprofit shelter around the corner.
I think we avoided a major confrontation.
This is a failure of leadership.
No, my friends, it's not a failure of leadership. From the start to the finish and even after, the anarchists were housed. They were protected. They were not to be arrested by Seattle police. It's a staged, managed operation. And since Seattle, these same anarchists have been used in Washington, D.C. to create a state of emergency. For a day, they allow them to spray paint pig on police guards and attack officers. And then the police are released once they're at fever pitch. They are useful tools to neutralize the general population's ability to engage in political protest. After the anarchists had put on their display for the news cameras, the authorities had all they needed to rationalize a total suspension of civil as well as human rights. Publicly, in front of everyone's eyes, they started declaring that people couldn't have banners or posters or even stickers or buttons on their clothes against the WTO. Anyone who got in their way was arrested and shipped to a FEMA center, the Federal Emergency Management Agency. In direct violation of Posse Comitatus, had Delta Force on the ground from day one of the demonstrations and protest, continually integrating the local state, county, and city police under federal command. This should be a giant red flag for any American concerned about their God-given rights and their freedom in this country. You see, for over 20 years, the Federal Emergency Management Agency has been building and constructing, maintaining concentration camps as well as the personnel to incarcerate literally tens of millions of Americans. It seems now, with some of the latest developments, they are attempting, in a psychological warfare program, to condition and control the populace so the populace will actually believe that all of this is needed to maintain the public safety. You've already seen the facts, my friends. All of the problems in Seattle, and yes, even in Washington, D.C. in 2000, could have been prevented. It's a handful of violent offenders offering the crisis so they can offer their solution. I would ask the police, why are you engaging in this? You know it's all stirred up and stage managed, as well as the military. Why be parties to this? Why be parties to destroying the country that your children are going to grow up in? Why? You can stand up. You can stop it. You can educate your friends and neighbors. That's the solution to this out-of-control government engaging in mass mind control and manipulation of the police, the military, as well as the general population. Break your conditioning.
At least 250, perhaps more, and those that have been taken into custody from the streets of downtown Seattle protesting for a variety of reasons. The World Trade Ministers here on their visit. You see them here with their hands pretty much cuffed behind their backs with those plastic sort of strap handcuffed apparatus. They are being led into the Sandpoint Brig. Remember, we told you about this story, dancing all the way in some cases. We told you about this story a couple of weeks ago. A number of the neighbors in that area of Sandpoint Naval Air Station were shocked to hear that the old brig was being reopened just in case it was needed, and it has been. As we said, at least 250 arrests now, maybe more.
And we've seen 400 people arrested. The facility at Sandpoint, we're told, is full. We're told they did not create another one at Boeing Field. But they continue to arrest people, and they continue to crack down hard on the protesters this afternoon.
That no-protest zone, as we call it, is bordered between Lenore and Seneca and Bourne and 4th Avenue. We call it a no-protest zone.
Some people were taken in forcibly into the building to be booked, and those people, I'm told, have been refusing to give their names or their hometowns or any information to authorities. They are being fingerprinted, and some of those people have already been taken down to the King County Jail for additional processing. So it is a very, very slow process out here, and right now, as I said, it is basically a stalemate between the protesters that are here on the Metro buses. There's two Metro buses, basically half full, and the police who have been processing some, but now at this point it's a waiting game.
Emily,
Dan,
I would
Kathy,
have to
back
say
to
that police, while we all want to see people get their legal rights, I would think police are looking at this as kind of a win-win situation. Those people are on the buses, they're not on the streets.
Some of the protesters that are here now were earlier at the corner of 8th and Lenora, where about 40 people were arrested. They are pledging to make this a non-violent protest. They want to be able to make their point about the WTO. And now it seems, Brad, that really has shifted more from the anti-WTO stance to an pro, constitutional rights. And we're seeing chants now instead of down with the WTO, it's like freedom of assembly, freedom of free rights. These people are angry about the fact that they're not allowed to protest peacefully today.
That certainly does seem to be the case. Let's go to Nicole Rodriguez, who's down there in the action, to get her perspective. Nicole?
Hi, I'm standing here right in the middle of the crowd that's protesting, and I want to ask this person in front of me, sir, can you tell me what this is about when the police came in and...
Police never left. They've been here all day. From the moment there was any more than three or four people on the street together, they've suspended our right to gather together on the street. The Constitution's been suspended in Seattle today. These people were doing absolutely nothing.
Nobody was directly confronting the police. No one laid hands on anybody. Nobody touched property. And they were arrested anyway solely because the WTO comes to town. China and other foreign governments wander in here, and they've suspended our Constitution, supposedly the greatest democracy in the country. And now they're gassing everybody. What did you see here? Did you see any violence?
In downtown Seattle today, the First Amendment ended at 4th and Spring.
Any part of an organized protest today?
No.
Not only could you not say what's on your mind, You couldn't wear it.
What? Give me that.
Sir, let's not get into a big scuffle over here. Okay.
This man had an anti-WTO sticker on his backpack.
He took it off my...
There are no protests down here. You saw what happened yesterday to your city. We're not going to let it happen again, okay?
Not allowed to have a sticker.
Not here.
These officers stand guard at just one corner of a 50-block no-protest zone in downtown Seattle. Since a civil emergency was declared, talk of free speech, at least past this point,
it's a no-protest zone, sir,
became moot.
You just took his gun, am I right?
He did.
He reached onto his body and pulled it right off.
I asked if I could go through. He said, I couldn't if I had a button, and I wasn't going through the line, and then he ripped it off my jacket.
Now, if I say I'm protesting WTO, I can't go in. If my T-shirt said I supported the WTO, could I go in? That's not a protest.
It's a no-protest zone, hence no protest.
Backpacks and bags were also searched for banners or gas masks.
Gas masks are illegal to possess today in the city of Seattle.
How can you guys mandate something like that?
What's that?
Just curious, how can you mandate something like that?
Because they declared the city a state of emergency.
But you don't know what thoughts are in my head, right?
Well, I have no idea.
But
are you protesting? Are you protesting? It's a no protest zone down there. You go down there and protest, you risk arrest. Okay? I'm just telling you that. You understand that?
Okay. What country is it?
It's a situation that is clearly uncomfortable for those who want to get through to protest and those who block their way.
What we're trying to do is keep protesters out and the business people and citizens go in, okay?
City leaders believe the free speech of yesterday came at too high a cost. That's why, at least for today, the First Amendment ended.
Yes, the First Amendment ended, and the police got a chance to, well, confiscate political banners and train the public how to proceed in an orderly fashion to the camps. Internment camps or concentration camps are nothing new in the history of the world. As early as the 1940s, hundreds of thousands of Japanese Americans, many who were fourth generation, were forced into these centers. One area for the children, another area for the women, and of course the men. The men made good workers. Federal documents show that these programs were not scrapped. They were simply put into mothballs for later use. Recently, camp construction has drastically expanded here in the good old U.S. of A. And it has nothing to do with political parties. They're all two sides of the same coin. In the 1980s, the concentration camp program got a big boost. And a little bit later, we'll get into the big push, the 1990s, right into 2000.
Colonel North, in your work at the NSC, were you not assigned at one time to work on plans for the continuity of government in the event of a major disaster?
Mr. Chairman.
I believe that question touches upon a highly sensitive and classified area, so may I request that you not touch upon that, sir?
I was particularly concerned, Mr. Chairman, because I read in Miami papers and several others that there had been a plan developed by that same agency, a contingency plan in the event of emergency that would suspend the American Constitution. And I was deeply concerned about it and wondered if that was the area in which he had worked. I believe that it was.
May I most respectfully request that that matter not be touched upon at this stage. If we wish to get into this, I'm certain arrangements can be made for an executive session.
And tragically, the only member who got close was Jack Brooks, and he was stopped by the chairman. But the truth of the matter is that, yes, you do have those standby provisions, and the plans are there, and the statutory emergency plans are there, whereby you could, in the name of stopping terrorism, apprehend, invoke the military, and arrest Americans and hold them in detention camps. In times of passion and in times of great fear, what to the eyes of the person and the mind of a person in time of relative peace and stability seem impossible become very real, very logical, very possible.
I across the nation at airports and old military bases. They're installing hangars and structures to intern the American people under military control. They're also integrating local police. You've already seen some of the evidence. But even the town where I live, Austin, Texas, is not immune from these activities. The Robert Mueller Municipal Airport in Austin, Texas. Just one more town where the military and the police are moving in and forming bonds.
Folks, we've been denied access to the old Robert Mueller Municipal Airport. They just shut down about 2 months ago. All we've seen is a Fox News piece where they showed the detainment center they put in one of the old 747 hangars with bolts and chains in the floor and cots. And now the military's taking it over. So they shut down Bergstrom Air Force, and they've moved all sorts of weird army activity here to the front parking lot of the old airport. And in the back, they've got APCs and barbed wire and everything else you can imagine. It's 700 plus acres out here at the airport. And we just got word of this. It just never ends. It just never ends.
Let me do a sweep of the...
They're looking at us.
Who's looking at you at this point? Here comes one of the trucks. Let me get you interviewed. Hurry, he's coming. He's coming. I want to get you interviewed. Yeah. You stop him.
Hey, how you doing? What's going on, bud? We're just curious what the military's doing out on the old airport.
They're having maneuvers.
They're having a what?
Maneuvers.
We're told that there is a holding facility here on the old Robert Mueller Municipal Airport. A hangar to hold people.
Uh-huh.
Have you been inside there?
No, not since they fixed it up, I haven't. I was in the flood fixing it up.
How did they fix it up?
Travis County came out here and with some inmates, and they cleaned it all up, swept it, pulled weeds, and then they got inside and reinforced the doors and stuff with bars and stuff.
So they put bars on the one of the big hangars, right?
That's what I was told, yes. I've been in there.
Did you hear about the chains in the floor with the bolts?
No, I sure haven't.
Yeah. We saw it on Fox News.
We had known of the facility for months before the mainstream media reported on it. But we were barred access despite the fact that we contacted the city of Austin dozens of times. We also contacted Travis County, attempting to gain access to the facility. But again, we were barred. Ah, but the mainstream media, they can be trusted. It's so much fun. It's no big deal. It's nothing to worry about. We're about to air a couple of newscasts here. Now, I was saying from day one that Y2K, the rollover, wasn't going to be a big problem, that it was really an opportunity for the establishment to have an excuse to take over local police departments and to put in more and more federal control. And this has been borne out to be absolutely true. Because after Y2K, the new center is still lying in wait, manned by troops. Again, right here in America, as you have this merger of the police and the military for your security, they claim. The locals, they just buy the fraud.
And Diane, where exactly are you?
Well, you probably don't recognize it, but it's an abandoned hangar at the old airport just off 51st Street. Today and tomorrow, sheriff's employees are turning this place into a booking center and even a holding cell. Now, it really doesn't look like much, and okay, it's really not, but it is a perfect place to set up shop. Anyone arrested in the Travis County area during the New Year's Eve party for a Class C misdemeanor will be brought out here. Sheriff's officials tell me it's pretty primitive. Inmates will be fingerprinted and allowed two free phone calls. Then they'll be held here for about 4 hours, just enough time to sober up. Then they'll be released and expected to appear in court in the future. Only people who have ID on them will be brought out here, since they won't have the capability to run fingerprint checks and they're mostly expecting people arrested for public intoxication down in the A2K and 6th Street areas. This temporary booking facility opens up for business tomorrow night. That's Thursday at 8 o'clock.
We're hoping to get staff acclimated to working in this environment starting tomorrow, with hopefully a low volume of arrests. So hopefully by come Friday night, everyone will know how the flow is going to work in here and be used to it.
The holding cell is surrounded by this chain link fence, and the fire marshal has told the sheriff's department that they can hold about 380 people in here, and the sheriff's deputies are ready for a busy night Friday night.
Diane, lots of space out there to sober up.
Now watch, two separate newscasts, and they both say the same thing. Oh, it's no big deal. Oh, it's a small little thing. No problem. It's really no big deal. Just get used to it. Boy, their newscasts are really close together. Yeah, just don't worry about it. It's just a thing out there with the military. Well, I really should be fair. There was one difference in the newscast. One newscast did show the bolts in the floor and the fence inside. And the chains running through the galley-like setup, but the other one didn't.
What's going on at the old airport?
This is where the party could end up, Walt, if A2K and Y2K partiers do get out of hand. The sheriff's office has taken an old hangar out here at Miller Airport and turned it into a makeshift jail, a holding cell. You can see where they even had to hand-make a sign. This is where they'll bring the minor offenders, mostly the drunks. They expect more than 100 people. It's quiet right now, but they expect once the parties pick up, so will this little mini jail that they've created out here at the airport. But before we arrived here, we wanted to also drive around town and see what else is going on in Austin tonight.
I'm going to do stuffed sole.
Well, I'm going to do you a favor. We're going to skip the cooking recipes. See how they equate cooking with, oh, camps out at the airport. And then they cut back to the camps. More psychology. I don't even know if these reporters know what they're doing, or is it just the training? Ah, yes, fireworks and pizza and a video with the family and the strange facility out at the airport.
And he says one of his biggest clients was the city of Austin. He says he sold more than 40 cases of ready-to-make meals to the city. So it seems like everyone is ready for just about anything, from home to here at this makeshift jail. Walt?
Okay, at least there's plenty of parking at the airport there.
And there's plenty of parking for anybody who wants to come down here and grab a cot.
All right. Thank you, Ann.
Well, I guess you're starting to pinch yourself right about now. You think you're an Invasion of the Body Snatchers or John Carpenter's They Live, or perhaps John Carpenter's The Thing. Look at them smiling. Oh, you can come down, have a cot. I've lived in Austin for many years, and I've talked to many people. No one in any memory can remember any problems in Central Texas, riots, you name it. Why then have they refurbished this hangar and turned it into a detention center? And again, why is this trend growing across the country? They may use a lot of different excuses, but we all know what's behind it: control. Long before Columbine, we were out on the scene in Austin, Texas, exposing what was happening to the middle schools. They're being turned into mini prisons. Oh, and guess who's behind it, keeping our children safe again? The Federal Emergency Management Agency.
Our children being brought up in a police state mentality. Thumbs scanning to get driver's license, cameras on the street corners, cameras inside the schools, and fences around the schools. All part of federal schooling. And again, Clinton wants to expand this even further. What type of society are our children growing up in? Big Brother. They're going to take good care of them. Well, here we have it, keeping the youth safe. Locked from the outside, locked from the inside. Again, this is the village, Hillary Clinton's village. This is reminiscent of the Soviet Union. Well, here we have some more of the security precautions to keep the children safe. We have the steel grating on the windows. Again, all part of keeping the children safe for all time to come. No way in. And no way out. Again, these children are not yours anymore. They belong to the state. We see the loss of parental rights accelerating. And, of course, the test scores drop. We see President Clinton vetoing vouchers, people taking their own tax money and sending their children where they wish. Where is choice with big government? It's non-existent. We're not attacking teachers here. We're attacking the central government. We're attacking what they're doing to our youth, the pattern of history being replayed time and time again. Again, one of many such doors. Again, Porter Middle School. The principal is out and can't talk to us about the barbed wire fencing. Hey, how you doing? Are you a teacher? How are you doing?
Fine.
My name is Alex Jones. I have an FM radio show and also have an Access TV show. How you doing?
Good.
What's your name?
Dina Will.
Dina Will. We've noticed that they're putting in two levels of fencing now around the school. Is that to keep out crime?
This fence has been like this for a long time.
Well, I know, but we talked to the workers. They're actually putting in another level of fence up front.
I did not know that. I think the fence up there is up front because of the construction, and it's to keep the kids from getting around the construction and getting hurt.
Yeah. How long has there been the cyclone barbed wire fencing here?
I don't know. As long as I've been here.
Is this a high crime area? I live in South Austin.
So do I, and it's South Austin.
So it's... is there federal funding for these fences?
I would imagine the same funding that comes to the school is how the fences got here.
Are most of the have you taught in other schools? Are there a lot of fences in other areas?
I've only taught in other schools in Houston. And yeah, there are.
When they have floods, do they use the junior high and high schools as relief areas?
Yeah.
So they do use the high schools and junior highs and elementaries as a relief areas during times of disaster?
Yes. Yes, they do.
Are you familiar that with the FEMA, Federal Emergency Management Agency?
No.
Are you familiar that only 7% of their funding is for floods and the other funding is military operations?
No.
And that it's FEMA regulations that are trying to push the fences around the schools?
No, I did not know that.
But you are aware that during disasters, even during the last flooding, they used high schools and such as areas for relief.
Yes, I did know that.
Are you aware of the master arrest warrant, the master search warrant that can suspend the Constitution and imprison people for having a copying machine or what the government calls propaganda materials?
No.
Does that sound like a representative republic to you?
No.
Doesn't? Kind of a rainy day, isn't it?
Sure is.
How are the kids doing?
They're doing great.
Well, I do appreciate you talking to us today.
Okay.
Thanks a lot.
Sure.
Come on, Mike. The most important thing that can be said about what's happening to most our middle schools and high schools is the fact that during disasters, they use high schools, gymnasiums, and junior highs for Red Cross relief centers and for FEMA centers. When you add this with FEMA, with the master arrest warrant, the master search warrant, and the military activities that they're openly engaging in across the country if locales want their funding, you have a recipe for disaster. They've used them for emergencies. They could use them for a national emergency to hold people in detention centers. These are detention centers set up as staging grounds to ship people out. That's not me. That's the Senate hearings. That's the documentation. Baker Elementary, the site of police training for terrorist attacks or hostage rescue of our children. I tell you, the government training centers are really delivering great education for our kids. How to grow up and live in a modern police state. Mike, let's just get the footage up close. Come on. Pardon me, sir? I'm Alex Jones. How you doing, bud?
How you doing?
So this is HIPS training, huh?
Yes, sure it is.
Government training centers. So what's HIPS training stand for? Homicide in progress.
If you turn that off, I'll discuss it with you.
Oh, you can't talk on camera?
I'm not going to talk on camera.
But I mean, it's for the children. It must be all right.
I'm not going to talk on camera.
Okay. Might get a shot of people as they walk by. Are there role players that are playing the part of a terrorist or anything?
I'm not going to discuss it. We're on camera right now.
Okay.
Get ready for part two of Police State 2, The Takeover, as we delve into America's growing secret police and their infiltration of American society at every level, and the federal government's big push to merge the military and the police with the general population, mirroring the East German Stasi. Despite the fact that I have the number one radio program in Austin, winning the Best of Austin Award, I was not considered mainstream media by the Austin Police Department. We called, again, dozens of times to Chief Nee's office, and we were always denied access to these different militarized police training exercises at high schools, elementaries, and yes, middle schools. The big question is, why all the secrecy? And I'll tell you why, and we'll document it. The FBI, under the control of the Justice Department, are running these operations. Again, most of the general population is completely ignorant of this fact.
So what's HIPS training stand for? Homicide in progress?
If you turn that off, I'll discuss it with you.
Oh, you can't talk on camera?
I'm not going to talk on camera.
But, I mean, it's for the children. It must be all right.
I'm not going to talk on camera.
Okay. Might get a shot of people as they walk by. Are there role players that are playing the part of a terrorist or anything?
I'm not going to discuss it. We're on camera right now.
Okay. My whole problem is this. Actual shootings in schools have gone down. Now you've got these MK Ultra events that have been going on. But other than those, you don't have any real shootings that are happening. And I think it just helps add to the whole sensationalism of it that the media is driving.
Makes it trendy.
Mm. Okay. Well, I see your point.
Huh. Yeah. Did you hear about Theodore Kaczynski? L.A. Times? Harvard admits it?
No.
Well, they brought all the Nazi scientists after World War II, and at Harvard, the Unabomber was the MK Ultra mind control subject. Alexander Cockburn wrote an article on that in the L.A. Times. It was about last month. Really, really nice people they're making for us. Of course, I'm sure you heard about... It was in Texas Monthly last year. The FBI created that Klan group, tried to get them to blow up that gas plant up in chemical plant up in Tarrant County.
I didn't read that article.
Yeah, they won a bump steer award. Well, you remember Sheikh Abdel Rahman from the World Trade Center bombing? FBI helped them cook the bomb and had to train their driver, kind of drive it in there. Yeah, that's real, real nice folks. I mean, and they give you all this crap to clean up. It's real nice. What they do for us. I'm sure you're familiar with Hitler burning the Reichstag in 1933, right after he got into office. Blaming on his political enemies. It's a nice thing we're getting from Clinton. Well, they just funded martial law 2 weeks ago in the House, and it looks like it's going to pass the Senate, Section 1067 of the current defense appropriations package, to put the military on the streets with police for the mere threat of terrorism. And no longer will y'all just be getting surplus equipment. You'll be getting new equipment from the military, kind of like Mexico, I guess, where the police and your military just merge together. I guess we'll be a better country when we're like Mexico or Russia. Kind of the whole deal. Kind of the death of a nation.
Well, she told me it was open to the public, that some other media has been out here and stuff like that. She said that...
Other media...
She would send a senior officer out here to make a statement. That's why we came out.
Other media stations have been out here.
Uh-huh.
And it's even been in the American Statesman.
You're just out here because we heard we were coming.
He got a phone call at the station that y'all were going to show up.
Oh, really?
And so...
We're evil.
Since I... No.
Can we get that on film?
Anyway.
So you got to call at the station that
if
we were
going to
show.
If y'all make that phone call, then maybe we'll discuss the...
All right, Mike, go. Let's go call.
So we're the terrorists now.
According to FBI and BATF programs, in the high schools, junior highs, and elementary schools, the American people across the board are at least potential terrorists in the schools. And the children are being trained with toll-free hotlines how to tattle on their parents, their neighbors, or their classmates. There are literally hundreds of such federal front organizations administered by private organizations in a public-private partnership. One such program is the Wave America system, where children are literally trained to become members of the secret police. Only one more telltale sign of a nation entering authoritarian control. William Campbell, a concerned parent and a listener of my radio program, started mailing me these news articles over a year ago, before the Wave America program was announced. Wave America is truly a documented front of the BATF. The sheriff of his county received $112,000 to allow the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, and Firearms to actually deploy 5 to 6 agents as full-time teachers in the schools. Despite the fact that the school board rejected the grant twice, the program has still been administered. Over the objections of many parents, like William Campbell, Mr. Campbell brought up the fact that in the Columbine situation, the federal government had given hundreds of thousands of dollars to that school district, and that school in particular in Colorado, with death education. 2020 reported on it back in 91, laying in coffins, writing their obituaries. This is not the type of free federal programs that he would like to see for his children. But let's delve into this free federal program, and let's find out what the BATF has planned for North Carolina, as well as the rest of the country. You see, programs like WAVE and SAVE across the nation are just flashy fronts for the BATF and the FBI and their indoctrination of the youth. The BATF encourages children to turn in their classmates for, quote, discriminatory behavior, or if they're depressed, does mommy and daddy have a gun? Parents have shown the greatest concern, though, over the BATF's access to students' files, their school records, and juvenile crime reports, literally building huge databases, federal databases, on your children in the government training centers. The government also claims official ownership of all official work product. And the school has to sign a non-disclosure act, meaning that all of the information, all of the press releases, must go through the BATF, federalizing your schools. But it's no wonder that they want to keep all this secret, permitting the officers access to the playground and cafeterias to allow for informal interaction, allow weekend homework assignments. The list goes on and on. There'll literally be teachers in your schools training and indoctrinating children. They'll have them writing reports on their home life. They're already doing that in San Antonio, Texas. And the sheriff has signed on and agreed to play ball with these so-called free federal programs. We've already seen what they've done in Columbine. And don't forget, never forget, school boards across North Carolina have rejected these programs, but still they're being instituted to report on dangerous activity. Hooked in with Pinkerton security? It goes on and on, my friends. There's no end to it. You've definitely got to step up to the plate and get these programs out of your schools. They're being pushed by governors, presidents, and yes, even attorney generals. Learn to look for the buzzwords in your community. It'll sound good on the surface, but upon closer examination, you'll find out about what's really happening in your area.
If 50% of all learned human response is learned in the first year of life, then the word should be educare, not childcare. And teach our kids to problem solve. Teach our kids to communicate, to talk to each other. Not like this, not like this, not like this. But to talk and to listen and to hear and to solve problems. You can. It is possible to teach a child to resolve conflicts, to learn how to mediate. Let us get to that so that we get beyond youth violence in homes that we never dreamed would exist. Let us hear their call for help, but let's focus on community. Let's build federal partnerships. I never liked the feds who came to town and said, this is what you must do, and this is what we want from you. I like the feds who come to town and say, you understand your needs and resources better than we do. How can we work together as a partner to solve?
One more quick point about the Wave America program with the BATF. They actually pay children to tattle on their parents. Kind of like the drug war, another perfect case point example of problem reaction solution, creating secret police and highly militarized teams to strike out against the American people on a host of political issues, using the drug war as the crisis. We'll now examine the phony drug war and bring forth some of the real evidence of who's behind the importation of these deadly narcotics. Ah, who is this young man, this new SWAT officer out in Miami? And this gentleman. All part of terror. It's obvious. Why would anyone be wearing a Jason mask? And while they're gearing up to disarm the American people, they're arming themselves to the teeth. I wonder what's going on here, all this paramilitary training. Going back to the 70s, they conditioned us on television with shows like Special Weapons and Tactics. Yes. They're just keeping us safe from that horrible scourge of drugs, narcotics. Funny, the more drug interdiction, the more funding, the more drugs get out on our streets. Since 1993, triple the heroin's been shipped into the U.S. That's the FBI's own numbers. Double the cocaine. Don't worry, we'll just create more armored SWAT teams. They turn the poison of drugs loose on the street, and the low-level minions have their excuse to violate the Fourth and Fifth Amendment, posse comitatus, and engage in asset forfeiture seizure. But again, they're just wearing hockey masks now to, keep themselves safe and us safe. It's not about terror. So why don't you just basically tell us about some of the books you've written and also some of the documentation of CIA drug running that you've come across?
Well, I came to the table with a background in Air Force intelligence, 8 years during the Vietnam War, worked with the CIA and Air America, and so I know how the intelligence community functions, how it's organized, and after my discharge from the Air Force, I worked directly with the FBI's counterintelligence division for 3 years, and then that led me into contract work with the CIA in an obscure place called Mena, Arkansas. Back when Bill Clinton was governor and back when George Bush was the president. And I personally witnessed a complicity between these two men, Bush and Clinton, in terms of transporting cocaine into the U.S. For the purpose of sale to generate money to fight a war. And that war at the time was the conflict in Central America involving the Sandinistas in Nicaragua. In 1970, it's well documented that the organization that was flying the classified material for Air America, codenamed Scatback, was busted. This whole fleet of airplanes and pilots was busted for hauling heroin disguised as classified material in an attempt to smuggle that back to Hawaii. And if you get to Hawaii, then it's a free ride back to the United States, because that's part of the United States. There's
now,
no customs to clear.
That is documented there, but back to the absolute documentation. Tell us how you were involved in MENA with then Governor Clinton of Arkansas and President Bush, who had also been director of the CIA earlier in the 70s.
I met Oliver North in 1982. He was with the National Security Council. He's the man who recruited me as a civilian to get involved in the Contra resupply operation. He told me that this was taking place in Mena, Arkansas, that George Bush was overseeing the entire project in order to insulate the executive branch from the scheme, because certainly there were constitutional considerations there. I went to Mena. I met a man named Barry Seal, who I was told was the CIA contractor who had the contract to resupply the Contras. Sure, in fact, I found a large base there under construction. I was hired initially to be a flight instructor. I'm a certified flight instructor. My last tour of duty in Southeast Asia was to assist the Cambodians and equip them to fight a covert war. And here we were doing basically the same kind of training. This time we were equipping Nicaraguans to fight communism in Central America.
And did you ever actually see the cocaine, or you just were at the base and knew that it was being flown in?
No, I, after after walking around with blinders on for 2 years, it became to the point I could no longer deny what was going on. And as I document and discuss in my book, Compromised, it's a book I wrote about this subject, Compromised Clinton, Bush, and the CIA. In 1987, I came face to face with a C-130 full of cocaine, just literally tons of it stored in ammunition boxes on a flight that was returning. And from that point on, you know, I couldn't deny it, and I asked for a full-scale investigation and went directly to Oliver North, I might point out, to request for that to occur. And the investigation obviously didn't happen. I was labeled a security risk and a threat to the operation, which clearly showed to me that this was being sponsored and sanctioned by the U.S. government.
So they were flying guns out and coke in?
Yeah.
The heroin also?
I had no knowledge of that. It was cocaine.
Where are we going now today? Would you say that the majority of, how big a percentile of the narcotics coming into this nation are controlled by the National Security Agency or the CIA?
I have no way of knowing, but I use logic on these kinds of scenarios. If you are to believe the Pentagon, and I do, we have a security net over this country, down-looking satellites and radar that is designed to stop as small of an incoming target as a surface, as an air-to-ground missile launched from a Soviet MiG out of Cuba. Now, if that's the case, and you can do that, and I believe we can do that, that's been proven time and time again we can, you have to ask yourself, how are all these drugs getting into this country?
So what are the drug busts that we see? Are those cowboys or people that were not inside, who are not licensed drug runners for the CIA, being busted?
Oh, the independent, the entrepreneurs, the little guys, the guys with a Cessna that gets caught with a duffel bag full and goes to prison for life. The juxtaposition of that is a C-123 with 5 tons coming in unabated.
So, how do we stop this? Just education?
No. We the American people, first of all, say we don't want a war on drugs. I'm for total legalization of drugs.
Well, some people will be shocked by that, but back in the 1920s during Prohibition, alcohol abuse skyrocketed. It created giant armed gangs. If you make something illegal and risque, a giant black market rises.
Well, black market is what the problem is. The profits are there. Take the profit out.
And then it loses the flair and it loses the money.
Not only does it lose that, but anybody else still in the trade certainly surfaces as a cold sore real abruptly. The banks that launder the money would surface and probably go bankrupt. It'd be interesting as an experiment, I've always said, to let's say we're not going to do this permanently, but for 3 months, for 90 days, we're going to have a test, and we're going to legalize cocaine for 90 days. And just see the reaction of corporations, companies, big businesses that are in the drug business, and banks that launder the proceeds, and watch them surface, because they would go into withdrawal real abruptly.
Well, Mr. Reed, just two more short questions, and I appreciate your time with us here today. The general public has a gut-level feeling that the information you're discussing is true. Even Esquire did a large article 2 months ago about it in their September issue, documenting it, DEA people, carte blanche admitting it. And we've seen articles in early 97 about the Federal Reserve Bank of Dallas and San Antonio being caught with $3 billion of drug money. This goes to the highest levels. Truthfully, it's good to say we should decriminalize drugs. At the same point, isn't the war on drugs also creating the police state that they like?
That's my greatest concern. I don't say let's legalize drugs because I want to see you use drugs or anybody else. We have not had a war on drugs. We've had a war on our Bill of Rights under the guise of the war on drugs. I never thought I'd ever live to see the day in this country that I fought for to have roadblocks, arbitrary roadblocks. Now, passengers and vehicles have no rights, as you know, that the passenger has an obligation to show his or her identification.
Asset forfeiture, seizure.
The test case before the Supreme Court as we speak is, are the passengers' belongings in a vehicle subject to involuntary search? And I believe the Supreme Court will go along and say they, police have the right to stop and search you and me or anybody else in a vehicle. The Fourth Amendment is worthless. It's been trampled on. It's useless. And
this is reminiscent of Nazi Germany.
Absolutely. So if we want to return to a nation of greatness, we're forced to legalize drugs just simply to preserve our civil liberties guaranteed us under the Bill of Rights.
And then if some idiot wants to OD, that's their problem. Don't take my civil liberties.
To me, that person who OD'd is a lot less threat than a group of SWAT team officers kicking down a door inadvertently and shooting the wrong guy.
And saying it's because of drugs.
Absolutely.
That's their umbrella. Mr. Reed, thank you very much for talking to us.
Thank you.
Let me, if I may, end my formal remarks there. I don't believe we've got more than 5 minutes, but Dr. Falker, would it be useful if I took some questions here before we leave?
General McCaffrey, Alex Jones from KJFK Radio in Austin, Texas. I fully agree with you on the scourge of narcotics and their destructive consequences on the human brain. But something I find interesting is the massive evidence coming out in the past of our own government and other international organizations' involvement in drug smuggling. In fact, 2 days ago, you called Colombia an emergency situation, and you're calling for $1 billion and more funding. Well, your head of counter-narcotics and drug operations in Colombia, his wife was just caught shipping in masses of cocaine into the United States. This is from the Washington Post, sir. Also have Reuters right here on it.
Is there a question?
Yes, that's my question. I just wanted to state my facts because, you know, we're in this world where you ask a serious question, you're a kook. Let's talk about the drug running of this government.
Last time I got that question was the first press conference I had in Washington was an older reporter.
Now watch this diversionary response. He goes into how much he loves the children instead of answering the real question. Oh, and by the way, since my confrontation with General McCaffrey about 8 months ago at the time of the making of this film, the colonel has also pled guilty to narcotics trafficking, the head of drug interdiction in Central and South America, working for the man on your screen.
Let's talk about the drug running of this government.
Last time I got that question was the first press conference I had in Washington was an older reporter. And I said, I don't know. I've been serving the country for 32 years. I'm not running any drugs. Muy free, I don't think, is. I think the poor wife of the Nova commander in Colombia underscores the problem. Drug abuse and its consequences are not a problem confined to one subsegment of the population. It affects all of us. Corruption, illegality. 4 months ago, I visited one of my best friends, lifelong friends. The four of us grew up together in the Army. Very senior officer, three beautiful kids. The baby is 21 years old now. Kid looks like Christopher Reeves, handsome lad. We had a little chat there, the three of us, visiting the two parents and the boy. And he's in a wheelchair with major permanent short-term and long-term cognitive impairment. And they've chopped away the muscle mass of his right arm and right leg because he overdosed on heroin and was in a coma for 42 days. That's the face of drug abuse. And we've arrested former senior officials of the Department of Justice, mayors, sheriffs, officers in the National Guard. There are 38 cases of corruption in the Customs Service in the last 3 years. By the way, when I say that, I don't mean to imply, nor do I believe, that this government is seriously jeopardized by drug-based
calls. Well, I wasn't accusing you of drug running, sir.
No, I just...
The NSA and the CIA, and y'all just make sure everything, you know, go after the cowboys, they give you a target to go after, they're...
What do you got,
mm-hmm. Hey, General, I wasn't accusing you.
Yeah.
But, hey, we know what's going on. It's funny, isn't it?
You had to be there to see it. McCaffrey just simply laughed after he walked by. Yeah, yeah. See, he had his little emotional speech up there about the baby, trying to win people over with emotionalism. But he's a cold-hearted dealer in death. And yes, now with more research, I will accuse McCaffrey of being a drug runner.
General McCaffrey, there's a lot of documentation on the drug running, sir. There's massive stacks of evidence, General McCaffrey.
I'm glad to walk on home, bud.
Are you really? Are you violating my civil rights? Or my God-given rights, I should say better.
No, this is closed press right now, thank you.
Oh, closed to press right now?
This walk is, yes, sir.
Oh, this walk is.
Yes, please.
Oh, okay.
If you'll respect our...
There are people walking all over the place. They got some Army intelligence gentlemen. Following me along.
Does this go out? Right,
oh, really? No? The general isn't here? There weren't a bunch of Navy people in uniforms?
He's not active duty.
Oh, well, I know that. He's active cover up. Yes. Thank you very much. Y'all have fun. The officer's dean.
McCaffrey was giggling and smirking the entire time, and we didn't catch it on video where these guys were trying to shove me up against a wall. Little boot licking slime balls, right here in America.
I don't care if there's drug dealing. I don't care if we're the biggest prison state in the world. Yes, growing faster than the internet. I have power. I know the general, General McCaffrey.
Lack of honor, my friends. That's what's destroying this nation. What you're seeing is real. April 10th through April 20th in Swansboro, North Carolina. This has been repeated across the country in the last 2 years. So-called urban warfare training in America. Of course, in the case of Swansboro, they actually pulled people over and searched their vehicles with the local police department. A local listener sent me this video of the Swansboro incident. You see, they take out groups of young officers from across the country in the Marine Corps and teach them that it's okay to go into American towns and cities and take over the city halls and search vehicles. In this training exercise, it became real. They become so arrogant, they just follow their orders and began to search people's vehicles. And as you're about to find out, it's not just the Marines, it's the Army too, in Central Texas. Well, here's some Marines training to search people's vehicles, and guess what? This is some poor Swansboro resident that had to come through the checkpoint to get home.
Searching the vehicle right now.
Three officers, this is DPD. We copy your last. Stop the vehicle. Have two male detained. Keep us abreast of what is going on with the situation. Copy.
Roger, I copy.
Well, I'm glad the Marines are learning how to do their police work, and, well, here's two of the troublemakers now that they've apprehended. But before you can set up your checkpoints, you've got to first move out and create a perimeter.
Okay.
this is all extremely healthy for the locals to see. It's to train them that it's all, completely normal. To have troops running around your neighborhood at night pulling vehicles over. It's all part of living in America. I wonder what the government's so worried about in the future that we need to have all this training. Training to take over our streets.
45. Down to 17. And I want you to go down to South Water Street to 45-3. Thank you.
How long will you gentlemen be running these operations?
We'll be out here most of the week, sir.
Get ready for the biggest bombshell of them all. The document on your screen comes from Fort Hood, Texas, the largest U.S. military reservation in the Western Hemisphere. In 77 Texas counties, under the guise of bomb disposal, the military is serving search warrants with SWAT teams, civilian police SWAT teams, in 77 Texas counties. Illegally violating every canon of a free society, the military openly invites police, state, county, city, you name it, for any reason at all, to call the military 24 hours a day for assistance. Please do not hesitate. Do not feel as if we are a last resort asset. We are here to support you 24 hours a day. All of our personnel for your agency and other agencies. Do not delay. Signed, Mark E. Crusoe, Captain, U.S. Army, Commanding Officer, 77 Texas Counties. The infiltration has begun. Here's a list of the 77 Texas counties where the U.S. military, the Army to be exact and specific, is operating in. From Anderson to Bell to Williamson. Oh, but one county is conspicuously absent. That's Travis County, the county where I live, where Austin, Texas, the capital, resides. I found out about some of this 2 years ago, got involved, and stopped it. We called Fort Hood. And yes, their military police did confirm that they were even on the local Killeen SWAT team, the town outside of Fort Hood, and that it's going on all over the state of Texas. For more information or to get a copy of the actual document in our possession, go to the website Infowars.com. You can also see still photographs of a bus search in Temple, Texas. Mike Hansen, my cameraman of many years, was traveling from Austin to Waco to cover a story when he happened upon, on the northbound lane of I-35, military and police searching a Greyhound bus. So he stopped to investigate and noticed that the military were covering their faces. This is the same place that Mike was given the document that we just showed you, where the military admits that they're serving search warrants to civilians' homes with the police and a host of other civilian law enforcement actions, direct violations of posse comitatus. There were also plain clothes individuals who were obviously military, working with the troops as well as the Temple Police Department, State Police, and BATF, who were all on the scene. But most shocking of all, our sources at Fort Hood tell us this entire operation was only a training mission at the expense of Greyhound and their passengers. Mike then noticed helicopter pilots, but he could see no helicopters. Of course, a little bit later, from behind the field off the highway, the first of two black helicopters took off.
Okay, we're here with the EOD, the Emergency Ordnance Disposal. Hang on a second. That's not what they are. I don't get what EOD stands for. Hell.
All I want, can I get you standing right there?
Sure.
All I want is you're saying there's some people here that we're not allowed to film.
Right. There's some people here that we would ask that Well, hang on a second. Why would you want that on camera?
Because I want to know who it is that is here that we're not allowed to film.
Well, I'm not saying you're allowed to film them.
You just don't want their faces.
Right.
But who are they?
People here from Fort Hood who are with the Bob Schools unit that we would ask the media not just to film their faces, get the back shots of them walking away.
Okay, but if they're out, if we have no such thing in this country as a secret military, if they're out in the public, we should be able to film whatever we see. We should be able to.
You can film whatever you want. I tell you what, you do that. We'll send you a press release. Okay.
Okay, but wait a minute. Wait a minute, Sergeant. Lieutenant.
I'm through.
You said a while ago that we're not allowed to film their faces. I've done stories in the past where. Delta Force, which has been training in South Texas, they didn't want us to film them either.
These are the guys that we work with all the time. We know these guys.
Okay.
They've asked us.
Why wouldn't they be wearing? They should be wearing black ski masks if they don't want to be seen.
Well, I'll tell you what. If you want to film them, I'm not inhibiting. Your freedom of the press in any way.
I was just driving by when I seen that.
You're welcome.
I'm on my way to Waco to do another story.
Right.
Not even have my good camera with me.
Okay. Yeah. So that was their request. We tried to honor their request.
But who are they?
Who
are these people that you're talking about?
Oh, okay.
No. So you don't want to talk about it anymore?
Not anymore. No.
Why not?
I don't want to talk to you anymore.
Okay, but
that's my freedom.
Who are these people?
Thank you very
Lieutenant,
much.
Okay. Lieutenant, who are these people? You're not willing to tell us what's going on here.
I'm not right now.
Why not?
Well, because you don't seem to be very cooperative with me.
I'm very cooperative. We just get stuff.
I understand.
We just get stuff. We don't want the party line. We want to know the scoop that's going on.
Well, I would be happy to tell you that.
Whatever you want to say.
I've been talking to the media for about a year and a half. You're the first one I've ever had once they gave me on camera doing everything. I've been doing this for a long time. So you just made me feel a little nervous.
I just want to, nervous, because I'm asked the question about who these people are.
No, because you're trying to get me on camera, I'm a part of a conspiracy or something.
It's a conspiracy. Okay, here's my feelings of this. We should be able to film whatever we see in open public.
You can.
But you said a while ago when I first walked up that you didn't want us to film whoever these Army guys are.
Right.
Fort Hood.
Now, a tactic we use when the police are being a little bit ornery or other so-called public officials or public servants, we like to aim the camera at the ground or to the side and basically get the audio. Now, you're going to hear, some interesting revelations here in just a second. Them admitting that the military does some things and they don't want the public to, quote, know what they're doing. So listen carefully.
Like these guys I work with all the time.
I wouldn't say I was going to do it. I'm just wondering why they asked us
because they do stuff to something like this or whatever, and they just don't want anybody to know what they did.
Yeah.
Which for us, these are the guys we work with.
So how far can we get where we can just get some shots?
Well, how far do you need to get? If you want to get right up in here.
Yeah, where we can see what they're doing.
Oh, coming over here.
There's no doubt about it. Get the shot. They're walking away.
Just don't get their face. That's all we ask. That's what they ask us.
Okay, so that's the Army right there.
Yeah. The ones that the fatigues are. So now we're taking all their stuff off one at a time, two people at a time. We're going through their gear. And then after that, we're going to search the bus one more time and we'll be done. Put the passage back on and let them leave.
Okay. How did they get here? Where's their truck? I mean, but where's their Army car or whatever? So we can get that? Oh, it's right there?
Yeah, well, they've also asked you if you didn't film the equipment.
according to Mike Hansen, and the tape does show it, that gentleman right there seemed to be calling the shots, the plainclothes gentleman with the police officer. In every one of these operations we've studied, there is always an FBI handler merging the military and the police. I think this footage speaks for itself. How are you liking your secret police, America? Mike Hansen only had an hour and a half of videotape in his camera, so he had to leave. We're told the exercise went on for 9+ hours off of I-35. Mike had been there about an hour requesting some type of press release of what was really happening, when suddenly this silverish-blue Crown Vic pulled in, and some type of law enforcement officer, some other handler, gave a copy of the memo to the Tybalt police, who in turn gave it to Mike Hansen. And we'll show you some video of that here in just a second. And the reason we're proving that we got this document from Fort Hood is because it's so shocking. They admit that they serve search warrants to people's homes with local police. We're talking about U.S. military in police or camo uniforms busting down people's doors. And they become so arrogant that they've got the nerve to put it in a memo and admit they're doing it and then hand it out to us on the side of the highway when they've got a Greyhound bus pulled over and they're searching it. It doesn't get any more secret police than this. The military, working in civilian law enforcement, welcome to Mexico or Russia.
Hey, we're going to ask that I give you this.
Good.
This will explain how, what they do and how they do it. And why they do what they do, okay?
Okay, but our only question is the military is not supposed to be working with local law enforcement.
Right.
Y'all are supposed to be taking care of these problems, not military is supposed to be Bosnia.
Right, that's what this explains,
okay.
The agreements.
I'm glad you gave me this.
Right, this is their document that says why they do what they do, the agreements they have with civilian law enforcement,
okay.
And that kind of thing.
Why the military is hiding their faces.
Oh, I don't know. That's what they ask.
I understand that, but they should, if they're doing something just,
right.
If they're doing something just like y'all are, they should have their faces.
What I would suggest you do is ask Fort Hood spokesman.
Believe me,
that, right.
This is going to be a 2-hour show tonight. Believe me.
I'm glad you, okay.
All right. Thank you,
but
sir.
I didn't want to get that to you.
All right.
Mike had been there about an hour when suddenly dump trucks from the city of Temple, Texas started showing up. Mike witnessed the police and the military ordering and directing them around to block Mike's camera view as well as the view of the mainstream media. Again, if the police and military are just working together to keep us safe from mad bombers, why not let the media get a view of what's happening? The facts are, my friends, this entire mission from our sources at Fort Hood was nothing less than a training mission. Of course, unfortunately, the local Temple police weren't let in on this secret, and neither were the terrified people on board the Greyhound bus or the driver. All of this at the public's expense. Unfortunately, it only gets worse. The Des Moines Register in Iowa, March 28, 2000. It seems it's an everyday occurrence to have the National Guard out for, quote, safety checkpoints being conducted with local police. Also in the April 10th, 2000 edition of Around Iowa. It seems they're having to propagandize the local public via the papers and condition them that it's okay to have the military out in police uniforms and dressed as civilians. Oh, that's not a telltale sign of the secret police. But don't worry, it says questions have been raised about the use of plainclothes Iowa National Guard troops. But Major Michael Kuhn, a lawyer for the National Guard, he says there's no problem. Why, he says Congress says that it's A-OK. Well, I guess they've scrapped Posse Comitatus and we're going the way of Mexico or Russia. How can any serious American watch this? Anyone that has an even basic grasp of human history. My friends, this is the battle for the Republic. Mobilize against it today. You may be saying to yourself, well, it's just in Iowa this is happening. No, Knoxville, Tennessee. There's the Knoxville News Sentinel, mainstream newspaper. That's right, and the sheriff, Richard McElhaney, says, I'll do anything I can to get drugs out of this county. Wonder who's bringing them in, though, to cause the crisis so they can offer their solution. I wonder why scenes like this from Swansboro, North Carolina, are becoming an everyday occurrence, and we're being conditioned to accept it, along with the police and the military. It's all part of living in a command-and-control society. As we speak, the federal government is stealing private property by the tens of millions of acres. Of course, they claim it's for the environment. But take heart, America. I have a local affiliate to my syndicated radio broadcast in Knoxville, WHJM. We were able to rally against the checkpoints there with the National Guard, and it was put to an end. It was stopped. And right now, Richard McElhaney, the sheriff, is fighting for re-election. That's what it's all about, America. Taking action and getting in their face. This is not something that Americans should be made to accept, the National Guard's so-called assistance to local law enforcement. It's all part of a greater federal takeover of every facet of American society and our freedoms. One only has to look at the birthplace of SWAT, Special Weapons and Tactics. Los Angeles, where the police have become killers, not defenders and protectors of the people, where they give each other rewards for shooting innocent people. They've now pled guilty to these crimes.
Well, here we are in Florida, at the Hernando County Airport right outside Brooksville, Florida, where Army Special Operations along with Air Force Special Operations are training. We'd have no problem with that except for one thing. It's in the middle of a populated area. And most importantly, they're training with SWAT teams, the Hernando County SWAT team, and yes, ladies and gentlemen, the state police SWAT team from right here in Florida. We've seen countless training missions along these lines, some far worse and some less intrusive, all across the country. But make no mistake, this is a new phenomenon right here in America.
Are you Mrs. Dana?
Yes, I am.
Hey, Alex Jones. How you doing?
I'm
the documentary. I'm also sitting here right now.
Oh, hi.
How you doing? We just want to know if we can ask you some questions here behind the board or wherever it is. About the Army and Air Force Special Operations in conjunction with the SWAT team. Here in Hernando County?
You know we're not in charge of the operation, and so they're answering questions that the media has.
I'm just asking about the law enforcement's role in the training, as reported by the local newspaper.
Well, I prefer that you just talk with them. They've asked us to just refer all questions to them. Now, I honestly, legitimately do not know what exactly they're doing. I just know that we are providing some SWAT team members, and we've been cooperating with them. I honestly don't know. I haven't been out there. I haven't seen anything. I haven't even talked to Captain Blake.
The real story of Brooksville is the way the people behaved. We got the military's training canceled by our presence, but not before we saw the bizarre Twilight Zone behavior of the locals.
You listen to some of the broadcasts, and they want to know.
We'll be watching the program to find out what type of training they're getting. How stupid do you think they are?
Do what?
The crooks will also be watching to see what kind of training that they're getting.
Well, our military will take out the crooks. That's a free country.
That's basically what's happening.
The military needs
personally, I think the SWAT team training, the police training should all stay a secret. What? I want it to stay a secret. Because if somebody
your
comes
police training
starts,
the military?
If the police are training the military,
good.
Good. They should. They should also learn martial arts.
Well, that's fine.
I happen to believe that every cop should know how to do that. And if a crook pulls a gun, take them out. People want to go in.
Yeah, hey, listen, I really appreciate your time.
Personally, I think the crook should stay stupid for a
while. Honey, you did just clap whenever you said she was talking about keeping the training secret. You clapped?
For our SWAT team.
Will you clap for us on camera?
They should say stupid.
But you did clap.
I'm glad people are.
Well, we don't want to know specific tactics. We just want to know what does taking over an airport have to do with the Hernando County SWAT team?
Yeah. What is?
Did you talk to Captain Glick?
Yes, we did talk to Captain Glick of the U.S. Army Rangers Airborne Corps. We'll get to that in a little later. But first, let's show some more of the bizarre behavior of the locals and talk to some other officials as well.
Tell everybody everything.
Well, tell the camera. We need to know. Here, tell us.
You did tell the camera. You're stupid.
We need to have the military secret with our police to keep us safe, right?
That's right.
We need to be safe.
Personally, I would just as soon as go under martial law with some of these crooks that are getting out on this early parole thing.
We didn't want to bother you while you're eating the meal about Army Special Operations and Air Force Special Operations here in town.
Can't tell you anything about it.
Well, what about the SWAT team working with them?
Can't tell you about it.
Can't talk about it, sir? That doesn't violate posse comitatus or anything?
Good.
Well, how much money is the county getting for training? Thank you. Appreciate it, sir. Thanks a lot.
Look at the smug on their face.
They love it.
Driving away in his black Crown Victoria.
Get the license plate, handsome.
I got it.
We blew their training mission in Brooksville, Florida. You're looking at the Hernando County Airport right outside Brooksville. Since we did this report, they have attempted to set up a whack-and-hut prison camp facility with the military at the old civilian airport. They've also thrown out the old-fashioned Army National Guard and moved in the 3rd Battalion Special Forces. Oh, and it just so happens the county also has their new prison camp facility right across the street, complete with bunkhouses and concertina wire. We alerted the public to this operation. They took action, and Whack-A-Hut has subsequently lost the contract.
First delivery.
Here comes another one.
Second delivery of concentration camp victims. Second delivery of concentration camp victims.
I'm gonna night vision this guy.
We don't have time to get into how we were chased by dune buggies and helicopters. The point is, every time we turn on our infrared, we'd be chased because it was like a giant spotlight inside their night vision. We'll get to that later.
I don't know if you people can see this, but we have two helicopters. They're hovering over the place where we were supposed to be today. And they're circling looking for us.
The scaled-back mission turned into an attempt to capture us for simply trying to catch video of what the military and the police were engaging in. We were chased by doom buggies, black helicopters, you name it. Unfortunately, it was next to near impossible in the darkness to catch any video of this without using our infrared illuminators. But again, it's like a giant spotlight to all of their night vision. Luckily, a local who had read about the training in the newspaper tried to catch a view of what was happening and actually saw the dune buggies in pursuit of us.
People are running these dune buggies up that way and then back.
Did you see
them?
Fast. Did you see the dune buggies do anything else?
Well, they stopped at the about a half a mile up there. I think one guy got out and went out this way, away from the airport.
You saw somebody get off the dune buggy?
Pretty sure, yeah.
Did they look like military personnel?
No, they just looked like, you know, men in black. And, of course, they had these black hats on, like the old-fashioned Nazi helmets. I mean, not quite that like that.
Really?
Well, you know the kind of hats they have now. They kind of almost look like Nazi helmets, but they were black.
We tried to talk to Captain Glick of the Army Rangers in a free country on public property outside the airport. So he went inside and just called the police, and we were polite. Boy, we are extremist dissidents engaging in thought crimes.
Excuse me one second.
I'm not trying to preach at you. I just want to get your opinion.
No, I understand.
I just want to get your opinion about concentration.
If you could just excuse me for 2 seconds, I'll be right back. I want to get this...
We're just curious about the SWAT teams. How many different members of surrounding SWAT teams are here?
Again,
Is that classified?
They were members of the sheriff's department. Members
SWAT
of the sheriff's
team,
department.
The paper reporters.
Again, if some of them were members of the SWAT team, then some of them were members of the SWAT team. But they were here role playing.
Oh, look, look. What you asking? Hey, how y'all doing?
We're good.
Good. How are you doing today?
Fantastic.
What's going on, guys?
Oh, nothing. We're here
conducting an interview.
Yeah. Okay.
You finished with all your questions in?
Yep. Just about.
Would you like us to be finished?
If we don't have anything else and they don't have anything else to answer, then yes.
Go ahead.
Who called the police? You did?
No, I did not call the police.
Yeah. Is there a problem here?
Absolutely not.
Okay. I mean.
Well, great. The captain says there's not a problem.
That's fine. We got called here by a concerned citizen. That's what we're here.
Concerned citizen? What, at the prison camp across the street? Or
I don't know who called.
Okay.
Did you call, sir?
No, I did not call.
Call came in as anonymous.
Okay.
Anonymous, we pulled up here and we're quietly talking with Captain, and then three police cars pull up. We got a call from a concerned citizen.
Do you have any other questions?
No, I just appreciate you guys making this story. Huh?
Well, thanks for talking to us now. I know it's a late hour. Thanks for talking to me to the first day.
Absolutely. We just were wanting to know about the SWAT team.
Did you give Alex the number for the sergeant major or whatever?
Yeah. If you have a pen and piece of paper, I'll be happy to give it.
You know what? We can grab that out of the car for you in just a minute. Our big question is simply about the relationship between police and the military growing all across the country.
And I couldn't tell you about anything growing all across the country.
It's not growing?
About that.
It's growing.
I don't know. You know, Alex, I really
don't. It grows very strong in third world countries.
But I will tell you, you know, anything you want to know about this operation. But I think I've answered all your questions.
Well, great.
We also tried to talk to some of the locals on the other side of the airport. Seems the police had already given them a visit and told them not to talk to us.
The Army came in with the FBI. And
That's about it. Yeah, that's all I know.
Now, you guys live literally about 200 yards from where the action's been taking place, correct? What have you heard during the night that's going on?
Some gunshots, explosions.
Explosions?
Yeah, one night.
Was that Wednesday night? Wednesday night?
The first night they had it.
See, we got here, they scaled it back. They were going to have a big operation last night, but they didn't. Because they knew we were out there. Did any police come by looking for us back here?
Yeah.
They did?
Yeah. Told me not to talk to you.
Really? Oh, the local police told you not to talk to me. But you're not on a military base, and that's not a military base. It's a municipal airport.
I know, but, you know, it's, I don't know.
It's modern America, isn't it? So the police did come by and told you not to talk to us?
Yeah.
Really? Do you remember what deputy said that?
No, I shouldn't.
He just said it was that the Army had asked him to do that?
You are not.
Really?
That.
So the police.
I'm going to tell them that or not.
No, that's
well,
fine.
They said
honesty. So the Army said that had told the police that I'm a nut and not to talk to us.
My friends, you know there's a serious problem in this country. Now it's time to take action, and to do that, you'll need real solutions, not phony crises created by the federal government. All across the nation, there are ways for you to get involved. One of those solutions to educate and mobilize the public is Access Television. That's where I got my start 7+ years ago in Austin, Texas. The entire town, all those that have cable, are able to watch the show. We've changed the minds of literally tens of thousands of Austinites. You can make TV. You can get involved. It's a lot easier than you think. Believe me.
Well, media is power. I've said that 100 times. And you've got to have access to some form of media to reach the general public if you're going to affect change. And the enemy knows that. And that's why they've got a stranglehold on it. That's why I talk about information war. You've got to get involved in the information war, and micro FM radio is the place to be.
Everyone has an FM radio in their car or their home, and because of the low cost, it's springing up across the nation. Tens of thousands of low-power transmitters are serving their communities with powerful information and energizing the nation. Another tool that has the globalist and control freaks on the run is the Internet. My site, after 14 months of operation, now receives 9 million visitors a month. I suggest everyone get involved. But if you're not computer savvy, you can at least make copies of my documentaries and air them on Access Television. Give them to your friends, your family, your neighbors. Show them to your church or your school. It's all about educating the public and becoming your own press, America. The Achilles heel of the establishment is their enforcers. If you can educate police about the reality of what's happening, most of them will not want to go along with this criminality. You can also educate the public by calling into commercial AM and FM radio shows. And of course, if you see wrongs in your community, right them. Be leaders in your community. When a World War II veteran was going to have his home bulldozed by the city, we built him a new house. They destroy it, we rebuild it. Kind of reminiscent of Waco back in 1993. We thought what happened there was horrible, and we brought forward the evidence. And then we decided to go ahead and rebuild them a new church. And guess what? People from around the country got involved, and we were able to build them a new church. That's the volunteer spirit. And whenever tyrants come into your town or city, it's important to confront them, whether they're politicians or bureaucrats.
Over 4 years ago, I was interviewing former and current CIA officials about the Delta Force murdering people in Waco. They were extremely concerned. That's now been borne out in the Dallas Morning News and other publications. When are you finally going to come clean about the mass murder and using high-level special operations killers to kill Americans for publicity? Very important. Number one, about the Delta Force. Number two, Senator John Danforth, your special counsel. How can he be independent, as you and others have said, when he is appointed by you to investigate you? That's the questions. Thank you.
The crowd giggled and laughed, and Reno refused to answer the question. Makes you proud to be an American. Two other solutions all Americans and people globally should be aware of. Number one, we should all ask God for guidance and pray that he deliver this country and this world from these clutches of these degenerate dehumanizers. And number two, never turn in your firearms. Slaves are disarmed all throughout history. Please make copies of this tape, multiply them, or get original copies at 888-253-3139. It's a battle. Wake up to it. Knowing is half the battle.